Hi, it's Jesper here. This is part two of how to design for scale and automation. In part one, I outlined the theory behind scale and automation. So here's a quick recap. Everything in the digital world is data. Scale depends on data, not process. Scale is growth at near zero cost. So to create scale, we need a data-driven approach and a data-driven mindset. That covers the what and the why of scale. But what about the how? That is what we're going to unpack in this video. There are, of course, more than one way of creating scale. It depends upon your kind of business, the industry you are in, the data you create, and most importantly, the quality of the data you create. Today, we will unpack a case study and see how it's done. But let me first warn you. Typically, when we talk about growth, we talk about 10%, 20%, perhaps even 30%. Well, to that, I can only say one thing. Boring! As outlined in my previous video, scale aims much higher. That is why we often use the term multiplier when we talk about scale. And the multiplier in this case study is between 2 and 3x, or 2 to 3 times. That means that we are improving something by 200 to 300%. Before we start, some scene setting. No, not that kind of scene. This is a global software company. They are in the education business, so hence the customer typically is teachers and principals. The trial software process is critical to revenue generation. The current process, though, is manual and operates slightly differently in different parts of the world, and as a result generates inconsistent results. Customer satisfaction is decreasing, and competition is increasing. Not a very good place to be, and something needs to be done. What this organization needs is a global process with only minor regional differences. It needs a process that's agile and can change quickly to respond to changing and shifting customer needs and preferences. It needs quality data for better reporting, prediction, and of course, automation. It wants to be able to grow without adding headcount. The solution is, surprise, a data-driven system designed for scale and automation. And this is how it was done. And like any good drama, it will be outlined or described in three acts or three stages. First, we need to understand the process we want to scale and automate and what we're trying to achieve. In this case, our goal is twofold. First, we want to create compelling content for a prospective customer to encourage them to enroll in a trial. And secondly, during the trial, we want to create a really good experience with really good outcomes so that they purchase at the end. The first step is called qualification, and the second step, of course, conversion. Data-driven design approaches this differently. Rather than unpacking a process, we instead unpack, yep, you guessed it, data, and the data that drives the process. In this case, we identified three key pieces of data we needed in order to deliver personalized and compelling content. So the first thing we needed to know was the type of student. The second thing we needed to understand was the role that the prospective customer was playing in the process and at the school. And the third thing we needed to know was their goal, what they wanted to achieve. This type of data is called reference data, and it's the most important data behind scale and automation. It is also the least understood kind of data, but we'll talk about that in a separate video. There were two types of student, primary and secondary. We call this student type. There were four kinds of roles: teacher, principal, administrator, and faculty leader. We call this role type. There were 5 types of goals: engagement, personalization, analytics, blended learning, and diversity. We call this goal type. To make things clear and simple, I have selected a subset of types and a subset of the data within the types. This really doesn't matter. It is the mindset and approach that is important. Next, we needed to understand the relationships between these types of data. This is very important, and one of the key differences between functional and process design versus data-driven design is that all data relationships must be understood upfront before we design the process. I'm going to say that again. When we do a data-driven design, all data relationships must be understood upfront before we design the process. If we use data to design a process and we miss data, the process will be incomplete and it can't be automated or not fully automated. Traditional business analysis fails to produce automated and scalable systems because it doesn't understand, it doesn't try to unpack the required data and data relationships upfront. So I'll say it again for the third time, all data relationships must be understood upfront before we design the process. By repeating it 3 times, it's more likely to stick. Psychology calls this repetition compulsion, a term coined by Freud in 1914. Having said that, I think I stick to data and let the psychologist unpack that for anyone interested. So what were the relationships between student, role, and goal types? Well, student type is related to role type. The role types for primary is teacher, principal, and curriculum leader. The role types for secondary is teacher, principal, administrator, and faculty leader. So without even trying, we have defined the beginnings of our software trial process and systemized. It might look something like this. If we click on primary, we are presented with these 3 options. If we click on secondary, we are presented with these 4 options. There are 2 callouts here. Thank heavens I didn't pursue a graphics design career. And second, we preserve data quality by enforcing these relationships. If they were not mapped, any combination of student type and role type could have been entered. This may not look like a big deal yet, but at the end of the process, its importance will be clear. Are you excited? Are you ready for the next relationship? I should have warned you, data is truly promiscuous. Role type is related to goal type. The goal types for teacher is engagement, personalization, and blended learning. The goal types for principal is analytics and diversity. The goal types for administrator is analytics, diversity, and blended learning. The goal types for curriculum leader is engagement and blended learning. And finally, the goal types for a faculty leader is engagement, analytics, and blended learning. Again, without trying, we have further defined and refined our software trial process. So further systemization might look something like this. We click on teacher. We are presented with these 3 options. We click on administrator. We are presented with these 2 options. And here we have 4 callouts. The first one, that's just a confirmation of my lack of talent in graphics design. Second, again, we are preserving the data quality. Imagine if each type had 7 possible values. That would create 7 by 7 by 7 different combinations. That is 343 combinations. That's a lot of combinations to create personalized content for, especially as some of these combinations are invalid. call R3. Invalid combinations also make analytics and predictions harder. For example, it would be harder, if not impossible, to determine conversion rates and effectiveness of the content we deliver. 4. The agility of the process created. And this is the biggie. We change the process simply by changing data. For example, we could add a student type, such as preschool or tertiary, and suddenly cater for a new education segment. But it didn't stop there. By adding a few data-driven steps after delivering personalized content, we implemented the entire process in Salesforce and automatically created a contact, a lead, and an opportunity. And in some instances, we created a sale without any human intervention. I say that again, without any human intervention. This is an important distinction. In the analog world, we're used to friction. It exists everywhere. So when we are designing a process in analog world, it's about pulling friction out of the process. And friction is created, if you watch my previous video, by humans. So analog process design is pulling humans out of the process. Digital design and a digital mindset is different. There is no friction. There are no humans in the process to start with. So the mindset is reversed. So instead of pulling people out of the process, well, we can't do that because in the digital process, there are no people. We are putting people into the process. We are designing friction into the process where it makes sense. And how do we know if it makes sense or not? Well, that's data. Data will tell us where friction will add value to the overall outcome of that process. As I like to say, follow the data. Doing some fast forwarding, we mapped all the key touch points. The data-driven steps we just unpacked, the qualification process, is marked in blue. Then we overlaid the current state process and assessed the level of automation. Everything was red and manual, not a pretty picture, and a total of 38 FTEs, or full-time employees, were needed to operate the process. Next, assuming that the entire process is digital, we identify the specific touch points where we purposely wanted to add friction, that is human intervention, to lubricate the sales effort. We called it intelligent automation because we made it data-driven and based it on a customer profile. The larger the potential, the more human attention we added and designed into the process. And in reverse, for very small customers, the process remained 100% digital. When digging into individual touch points, there were some areas that consumed not only a large amount of human resources, but also inconsistent outcomes. These were critical touch points as they related to providing reporting back to the teacher or the principal during the trial about the performance of the class. And these reports suggested corrective actions for teachers or principals to take to increase results. Because we knew, through data, that if we could increase these results, the likelihood of purchase increased significantly. Data analysis had shown us there were three data points, and you see these marked in blue, that were directly related to increased results. The first one was how often the teacher logged in. The second was how often students logged in. And the third one was the number of assignments created. We extracted this data from operational systems, creating a data mart, and linked it back into the trial process. We also knew the optimal number of teacher and student logins and assignment creations. So each day during the trial, actual data was compared with this optimal data, and personalized reporting was generated and sent to the teacher so they could take corrective actions and create as good outcome and results for the students as possible. The result was a significant reduction in FTEs to operate the process, which were redeployed into other areas of the sales process. This is an important distinction. Creating scale is about growth and scaling up. It's not really about scaling down and saving costs. There are other ways of doing that. So by automating and removing repetitive work, we achieved a number of things. Not only improving the efficiency of the process, we also improved customer satisfaction. The full process was implemented within 12 months, and the entire project paid for itself within 12 months of operation. I hope this has shown the power of scale and what is possible through a data-driven approach. If you enjoyed this video, please like and subscribe. I'll see you in the next video.